Hello, and welcome to the Starry Trek Identification Guide. This video will teach you to identify starry stonewort along with other target invasive species that you will be monitoring for during Starry Trek. Starry stonewort has been described as having a grass-like appearance. It has whorls of 4 to 6 long branchlets, leaf-like structures, coming off of thin stems. As we take a closer look at the branchlets, note that they have a forked appearance at the tips and that the forks are asymmetrical, with the branchlet subtended by 1 to 2 shorter structures called bract cells. You may observe some unforked branchlets that do not have bract cells. Whitish bulbils do occur in other charophytes, but star-shaped bulbils are a unique feature that gives this species its common name. These may not always be present throughout the season, or may occur mostly in the sediment. Note the many small stars mixed in with this handful of starry stonewort. Closer images give a sense of the scale of these structures, and show what they look like under a magnifying glass. Clear cells called rhizoids shallowly anchor starry stonewort to lake bottoms. These look like fishing line and may have bulbils strung along them. Here, 3 of these rhizoids are highlighted so that you can see them more clearly. You may also observe male reproductive parts, called antheridia. These are small orange spheres, but are not present at all times of year, and native lookalikes can have similar-looking antheridia. You are most likely to confuse starry stonewort with other native charophytes, which are important components of Minnesota's aquatic plant communities. Chara, or muskgrass species, can have an unpleasant odor, often described as being fetid or musky, hence muskgrass. But these species typically have rough stems, and their branchlets are shorter and not forked. Starry stonewort has smooth stems and predominantly forked branchlets. It is also odorless, though like all aquatic plants, it may occur in mucky sediments that have a rotten egg type odor because of natural buildup of hydrogen sulfide. Nitella, or stonewort species, are another group of charophytes that could be confused with starry stonewort. In fact, the scientific name Netellopsis means like Nitella. However, whereas Nitella branchlets fork into tips of equal length, starry stonewort's forks are uneven in length. Also, if you pull Nitella out of water and hang it upside down, its branchlets droop, while starry stonewort's branchlets stay more rigid. Finally, starry stonewort is beefier than pretty much all of our native charophytes. It can grow taller, its branchlets are longer, and it produces denser biomass. It's also possible to confuse vascular plants with starry stonewort. For example, the native angiosperms sago pondweed or water star grass can also be described as grass-like. However, you will be able to tell these apart thanks to their flatter leaves, which are alternate, not whorled. In addition, their leaf tips are not forked. And you may observe reproductive parts, like flowers and fruits, that distinguish these species as angiosperms, not charophytes. While you are monitoring for starry stonewort as part of Starry Trek, you may encounter other potential aquatic invasive species, also known as AIS. The following slides will teach you how to identify 3 target AIS. The first is Eurasian water milfoil.
Feathery-looking leaves occur in whorls of 4. Probably the single most important characteristic to look for are the number of leaflet pairs. Eurasian water milfoil will typically have 12 to 20 leaflet pairs per compound leaf. Whorled flower spikes emerge from the water when Eurasian water milfoil reaches the surface. A common close relative of Eurasian water milfoil is likely to offer the biggest challenge to your ID skills. Northern water milfoil has a very similar appearance, but it has fewer leaflet pairs, typically 4 to 11, rather than the 12 to 20 found in Eurasian water milfoil. The overall shapes of their leaves differ too. Eurasian water milfoil has a more rounded appearance to its leaves, while northern water milfoil leaves are shaped a bit like a menorah.
During Starry Trek, you will also be monitoring for zebra mussels.
Zebra mussels are bivalves, meaning 2 shells, and so have two shells joined at a hinge located at the point of their triangular shells. Zebra mussels are known for the alternating light and dark brown stripes on their shells. The pattern on the mussel shells is highly variable. Some mussels even lack the striping pattern altogether and are a solid tan, greenish, or brown color. They have a flattened edge, and if stood up on this edge, called the ventral side, will generally not topple over. Zebra mussels attach themselves to solid substrates using byssal threads. Although, if a mussel is ripped from the surface it is attached to, it may leave behind the threads, and so they may not always be visible for identification purposes. They use clusters of these tan or black threads to attach themselves to items such as rocks, other mollusks, docks, boats, debris, and even aquatic plants. Zebra mussels can range in size from only a few millimeters as juveniles to as large as about 1.5 to 2 inches as adults. The veligers are free-floating and not visible to the naked eye, so require a very fine mesh plankton net to collect, along with a special microscope with cross-polarized lighting to identify. You are most likely to find adult zebra mussels attached to the underside of objects floating in the water, attached to submerged portions of docks and lifts, submerged debris, aquatic plants, and rocks in shallow lake areas. Zebra mussels may be mistaken for a number of other mollusks commonly found in Minnesota waters. Native mussels, often called clams, are generally much larger than zebra mussels in their adult form. They do not have byssal threads to attach to other surfaces and are usually found mostly buried in the sand or mud. Zebra mussels can oftentimes be found attached to the exposed portion of native mussels. Asian clam is another invasive species found in Minnesota. Like native mussels, they are not able to attach to other surfaces and are usually found in or on soft substrates like sand or mud. While zebra mussels have an asymmetrical shell shape like a wedge, Asian clam have a rounded, symmetrical shell with notable ridges. While mussels, including zebra mussels and clams, have two shells, snails have a single shell. Most snail shells have a spiral shape to them, except for freshwater limpets. Freshwater limpets are a type of snail with a small, flattened, cone-type shell. They are often confused with zebra mussels because of their shape and because they are generally attached to other objects. Upon closer examination, you should notice that they only have a single shell and they attach with their body, just like other snails, rather than byssal threads. Some snails are also invasive in Minnesota, such as the Chinese mystery snail pictured here. The closest look-alike to the zebra mussel is the quagga mussel.
The final target species you will be monitoring for is curly-leaf pondweed. Curly-leaf pondweed can be identified primarily by its leaves. Curly-leaf pondweed has alternate leaves with distinct undulate or wavy leaf margins. If you look closely, you'll notice that the leaf margins also have small serrations or teeth, as you can see in the magnified image on the right. Curly-leaf pondweed leaves do not clasp or wrap around the stem. This is an important way to distinguish curly-leaf pondweed from other native pondweeds that have clasping leaves. Note how the clasping leaf encircles the stem on the right. This concludes this training video. If you are interested in learning more about identifying aquatic invasive species, the AIS ID guide is available for purchase through the University of Minnesota Bookstore. Click the link in the video description below to learn more. Thank you for watching and have fun during Starry Trek!